Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
Psalms 8. It is going to be dealing with these different scriptures because the subject of this lesson is, why is God so concerned with man? And we're dealing with a series of passages that show how unique and how ultimate man is in the physical creation of God. Another parallel passage I think everyone will want to read is Hebrews chapter 2, verses 5 and following, that uses this same passage in Psalms to speak about the human divine Messiah, Jesus Christ. We're going to be beginning today in Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28, and Genesis 2, 7. These primarily are the creation accounts in the Old Testament. I'm going to be dealing with them from a background perspective to help you see what these passages mean. They're really introductory passage for us to go to Psalms 8, and we'll be dealing with that before the lesson's over. Genesis 1, 26. And God said. Now the word for God here, when it's capitalized G in your Bible, in these early chapters of Genesis, is the word Elohim. Now, if it's the word Lord with a capital L and all the rest are capitals, it's the word Yahweh. Now, many folks have said because Moses interchanges these two words, that means there's two sources. I reject the JEDP theory of source criticism completely. I agree more with the rabbis that the term Elohim speaks of the power and might and justice of God, and the term Yahweh is the covenant name for God, speaking of His mercy and love. Both of them are used through here. Although I don't deny that Moses used some kind of oral or written sources, I do deny that he just combined two accounts that were extant in his day. Now it says, and God said, let us make man in our image. Now the word us and our have caused much discussion. Many folks say, the rabbis say, it's the plural of majesty. Others say it's God speaking to the heavenly council of a group of angels around the throne. I am a Trinitarian Christian. I believe that God is a three persons, though one unity. I affirm the monotheism of Deuteronomy 6, 4, and 5, but I also believe that Jesus is divine and the Holy Spirit is a separate individual personality. Now, we don't see the full-blown Trinity here, but the plurality of God is a theological precept of the Old Testament. Not only is the word Elohim plural, not only do we have plural places like this, let us make man in our image after our likeness, but in Psalms 110, we have the Lord, Yahweh, said to Adonai. So we have two divine personages there in Psalms 110. And not only that, but in Deuteronomy 6, 4, where it has, Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one Lord, the special form of the Hebrew word one there means one with the possibility of plurality. It's the same use of the Hebrew word one where it says in Genesis 2, You'll leave father and mother and cleave unto your wife, and the two shall become one flesh. That's the exact same Hebrew form for one. So it means one with the possibility of plurality. There is a form of that word in Hebrew that means one and only one, but that's not used in that passage in Deuteronomy. So I believe this is an incipient Trinitarian formula, at least affirming the plurality of God. Now, it says, let us make man. Now, the word here is anthropos in the Septuagint. The Hebrew, it's the word Adam, or Adama, and it is the word for mankind. It's only translated Adam in these first few passages, okay? Let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Now, Roman Catholic theology has made a distinction between the image and the likeness. They say the image was fell, but the likeness didn't. And they say the likeness is man's mental powers, but the image is man's superadded gifts like no pain, immortality. And they do that because their system, especially Thomas Aquinas, bases the thought that we can know God through our rational processes. But I really think the Hebrew, instead of theological presuppositions, should guide our interpretation. Now, what we have here is a Hebrew parallelism. Image and likeness are in a Hebrew parallel relationship. They are synonymous. What they refer to exactly is hard for us to say with completeness. I don't think it's physical image at all, but the ideal of personality, the ideal of choice, the ideal of ultimate consciousness to know our own existence, those are some of the things that I think the image and the likeness refer to. It's referred to several times in the New Testament that though we are fallen, we are still in the image of God, which means we do not lose God's image, though it is marred by our fallen nature. Let me give you a few. 1 Corinthians 11:7, James 3:9. Then it says, let them rule over. Now here we have the plural already. Now whether we're speaking about mankind corporately or whether we're speaking of the man and the woman already is uncertain. Many people have tried to say that Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2 are two different creation accounts. That comes from an ignorance of Hebrew literature. In Hebrew literature, quite often there is a sharp, terse account followed by a detailed count, and that's exactly what we have in the first two chapters of Genesis. Not two parallel accounts, but a general account followed by a more detailed account. And that's just the nature of Hebrew literature. Now then it says, it mentions the fish and the birds and the cattle. This word rule over is a very strong term. It means trample over. It means have dominion. And that's going to be very important when we get to Psalms 8. Now, let's see. In verse 27 it says, and God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. There's that repetition to emphasize that we're in God's image, said twice. Male and female created he them. It had always been God's plan for sexuality. Although I believe that sexuality is part of time and not eternity, it is still in God's plan. Adam, even when he was alone, saw the other animals, saw that they were different, male and female, and he knew that he was a male, and so I think he realized there was something more for him. And I think that's incipient here in what we're talking about. I also think when it says he made male and female, we need to say, with all the authority of the Scriptures, that human sexuality is not an evil, nasty, dirty thing. It is a gift of God. It is God's idea. It is God's ultimate will for all men unless they have the gift of celibacy. But I want to tell you, sex is good and clean and wholesome and from God. Now, what all happens with all of God's gifts, man takes beyond the bounds of the God-given gift. And we've done it to sex. We've done it to everything. But that doesn't mean the gift's bad. It means that man is evil. Now, let's go over to chapter 2, verse 7. Then the Lord God, now here we have the word Yahweh and the word Elohim right together, the Lord God, okay, formed. Now this is a word that it comes from the potter. It means like to form clay. And so it's emphasizing the lowliness of man. Now listen to the tension. Man is made in God's image. Man is made in God's likeness. Man is a special creation of God, the ultimate creation of God. His majesty is emphasized. But he's made out of red clay. His lowliness is emphasized. So man is a dichotomy of lowliness and majesty all mixed into one. Many folks have said that man is like the animals, and that is true. In this passage, it's going to mention about man became a living soul. The word nephesh, it's a word for soul in Hebrew, the same word is used for the cows that's used for man. There's nothing about man's soul that's unique. It's the breath of God that gives man uniqueness. Now it says formed. All the rest of the animals, God spoke into existence. But because God formed man, again the uniqueness, the special creation of God is spoken of. Now from the New Testament passages, we know that it was not God the Father who has no body that knelt in the clay of that paradise. But it was Jesus Christ himself, pre-incarnate, that formed man out of the dust of the ground. We get that from John chapter 1, verse 3, 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 6, Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2. Jesus is the agent of God in creation. Now the word man is the word Adam. It usually means mankind. Here, it's many places translated Adam. It means red. The word of the dust is the word for clay or clods. We're made out of red clods, would be a little more literal Hebrew. I've known some red clods. No, I won't say that. From the ground. And breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Now, the breath of life, the word in Hebrew and Greek for breath can mean wind, breath, or spirit. Mean that God has energized man with his spirit. And that's what we're talking about. Now, notice where it says, and man became a living being or a living soul. That is the term nephesh. It's used the same term in Genesis for the cattle. Now, notice where it mentions them, that man became a living soul. There's much discussion in theology about, is man a unity, a dichotomy, or a trichotomy? Is man body, soul, and spirit, or body and spirit, or unity? It is my personal belief, based on this passage right here, Genesis 2:7, that man is a unity. I believe we have aspects to our nature, but primarily we are a unity. We do not have a soul, we are a soul. The body is the outward boundaries of our soul. And therefore, I think that God is always deals with man in a unity. He doesn't deal with our body over here and our souls over here and our spirit over there. He deals with man in his totality. Man is a wholeness, though there are biochemical, psychosocial, and ultimate aspects to our lives. Primarily, man is a unity. Though there was a time when man was physical and spiritual separated, when God breathed into Adam the breath of life, man would never be separated again except for the intermediate state of the dead. I've done a tape on that called Unity, Dichotomy, or Trichotomy, and I'd like to send you a copy of that if you'll simply write to me. Now, let us turn then to Psalms 8, if we could, and I think we're going to see this majesty and lowliness of man again. Now, Psalms 8 is the parallel passage to Hebrews chapter 2, and you'll really want to look that up. In Psalms 8, we have a psalm of thanksgiving to God for two things: for man being made in God's image, and man having dominion over all creation. Now, when it says, "The Lord our Lord," now look at your English Bible. I'm using New American Standard, as I always do in the Old Testament. You notice the first "O Lord" is in all caps. That is the Hebrew word Yahweh. I mentioned it back in Genesis. It comes from the Hebrew verb to be. It means the ever-living God. It's often translated, "I am that I am," or "I will be," or "I always am." But that's Yahweh. Whenever that R is what I look at to see if it's capitalized. Now it says, "O Lord, our Lord." The second word for Lord is the word Adon, or Adonai. It means owner, master, lord, husband. These are the same two words that are used in Psalms 110, one to describe Jesus, one to describe God the Father. "How majestic is thy name in all the earth." There are several passages where the name of God implies the presence of God. And so when it speaks of the name, it's speaking of God's characteristics, God's person, God's presence. Let me give you a few if I could. Exodus 20, 24, Exodus 23, 20, and 21, Deuteronomy 12, 5, and 11, 1 Kings 8, 27 through 30, and chapter 11, verse 36, Isaiah chapter 30, verse 27, where the name is used as a way of speaking of the presence of God. The Jews were nervous about pronouncing the name of God. They didn't want to take God's name in vain, so they would use other terms for God. The name of God, heaven, God's throne. And this is a kind of a Jewish way of talking about God without mentioning his name directly. Notice it says, "all the earth." It is very important that we realize that the ancient Jews did not believe in a local, tribal, geographical deity. Even though in parts of the Bible, other groups around thought that God was a mountain god and couldn't fight on the plains. We see that in the book of 1 Kings. In reality, God is the God of all the earth. There is only one God. There is only one, a creator, redeemer. And that's Yahweh, the God of Israel. That's why when it says the God of all the earth, it's going completely against the theology of its day in saying there is only one and only one God. That's the monotheistic nature of Judaism that's seen so completely, again in Deuteronomy 6, 4 and 5, called the Shema. Now then it says, "Thou hast displayed thy splendor above the heavens." And you'll see that in verse 3 it mentions thy heavens again. Now let's define biblically the word heavens. There are three primary usages, and the one we're using here is one of those. In Genesis 1 and 2, when God made the heavens and the earth, it's speaking about the atmosphere above the surface of our planet, where the clouds move, where the birds fly, the air that man breathes. That's what it means, heavens and earth. But here in this passage, it's speaking of the realm of the stars, of the planets, of the galaxies. And it's speaking of that realm where the atmosphere stops and then covers all of creation. We would almost use a parallel term from our Western orientation, the cosmos, the universe, and beyond. Now, what it's saying is that God has established the universe and the splendor thereof is taking a slap at the polytheistic worship of the stars and the moon that was so common, especially in Babylon in the Old Testament time. Then it moves on. Not only has God displayed himself in the heavens, but God has revealed himself to children, to infants. You see, the Bible has never said that man can discover God. The Bible has always said that God is revealing himself. God is pulling back the curtain. Man never discovers God. And that's what it means in verse 2 where it says, "From the mouth of infants and nursing babes thou hast established strength." There are two passages in the New Testament that have this same orientation. Matthew 11:25, Matthew 21:16. I'm sure you want to look those up. God always takes the initiative. The transcendent, the other, the holy is able to make himself known to the infant, the toddler. We're just not that smart to find God. But God's intelligent enough to reveal himself fully, even to the littlest ones. Now, notice that it says, "Because thine enemies, thy adversaries, to make the enemy and the revengeful cease." This is a very strange verse. We're talking about God, the only creator, redeemer. This is an oblique reference to the presence of the adversary, Satan, in God's creation. There is a struggle going on for the hearts and lives of men. Now, there is not an ultimate dualism like in Zoroastrianism. There is no Ahura Mazda and Angra Mayenta. There is no good and evil fighting it out to see who will win. No, God has always been in control, and evil is somehow in the will of God. But this is a reference to there is an opposition to God in man's world and in God's world. Now, in verse 3 it says, "When I consider the heavens the work of thy fingers." Now this is an anthropomorphic use. It is speaking about God as if he had a body. Now really, we have no human vocabulary except analogous vocabulary. We can only speak about God as if he was a human being, for we have no other vocabulary to use. But when we speak of God's finger or God's hand or God's anger or God's nostrils or God walking, we're speaking in analogous terms only. God is a person, but God is a spiritual person. He does not have a body, and yet we have to use human vocabulary. I've done a sermon on that. I preached it on Mother's Day one time called "The Femininity of God," and I'll send it in the back of this other tape I mentioned to you on Unity, and if you'll write me. Now, when it mentions, the second part of verse 3, "The moon and the stars which thou hast ordained." God is in control of the stars. They do not have an independent existence. They are not controlled by the angels or demonic. They're simply God's creation. Now in verse 4, we come into the heart of our lesson. What is man? Now the word man here is not Adam. It is Enosh. It's man in his weakness, man in his frailty. What is frail man that thou should take thought of him? And the son of man, there's the word Adam again, that thou should care for him. These are in a parallel relationship. Son of man in the Old Testament simply means human being. These are in a Hebrew parallel relationship. You might want to see Job chapter 7, verse 17, and Psalms 144:3 for this same usage. Why does God care about man? Why should God spend so much energy and time redeeming man? Why not God just make it over again? Well, man is frail. But in the midst of man's frailty, there is a majesty because we are like God. When I don't believe that man has always existed, but I believe there will come that once man is conceived in the womb of a woman, there will never be a time when that man ceased to exist. I believe in the eternality of the human soul after conception. Now, when it mentions here, this verse is the one that's speaking about God caring for us. Oh, friends, I don't know what kind of person you are. I don't know how rough a life you've lived or how good a life you lived. I don't know how much you love the Lord, but I know this. I know how much God loves you. And you can't go far enough. He doesn't really, really care about who you are and what you're doing and that you know him personally. Now, verse 5 has called a lot of tension. It says, "Yet thou didst make him a little lower than..." Now, my New American Standard has God, capital G. If you'll look in the margin, if you have a reference Bible, you'll see the word is Elohim. That word can be used for angelic creatures as well as the eternal God. Let me give you a few verses where it's used of the angels. 1 Samuel 28:13, Psalms 82:1-6, and the book of Hebrews. All New Testament authors used the Greek translation of the Old Testament, known as the Septuagint. In the Septuagint, and in Hebrews 2:7-9, it says a little lower than the angels. But I really think it's the Hebrews stronger than that. Man was made a little lower than God. Wow, that's saying something. Isn't that amazing? Let us crown him with glory and majesty. In the midst of man's frailty, Enosh, frailty, is man's majesty. What is man's majesty? We're going to find out the rest of this psalm. He's made in God's image, and he was given dominion over all the created order on earth. And you know, this verse really answers the philosophical question about who am I? Where am I going? Is there any meaning for my life? Oh, friend, there is, because God made you like you are. God loves you the way you are, and God wants you to be like him completely. Is there purpose in life? Yes, because of who God is. Am I a significant person? Am I worthy? Yes, because of the value that God has placed on you. Do I have real significance? Yes, because of who you are in God. Oh, yes. Let's go to the last few verses of this psalm. Thou dost make him to rule over the works of thy hands. You might well see Genesis 1:28. That's what it's talking about, having dominion. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heaven, the fish of the sea, whatever passes through the paths of the sea. Verses 6 through 8 are saying that man was given ultimate dominion over all of creation. Man was placed as the head steward over the creation of God. Now, theologically speaking, creation is simply the backdrop, the stage setting for God's love affair with man. But man is given a stewardship. As man was given work to do in the garden before the fall, there is a place for man to sense the responsibility of being a steward of that which God has placed in his possession. And that's creation. But for the most part, my friends, we have raped and abused and exploited God's creation for our own selfish, monetary-oriented pleasure lives. And we're reaping the consequences now. I think the reason there's so much cancer in our day is because we have so abused nature that everything we eat and breathe has the potential to destroy us. Now, it continues then when it says, O Lord, our Lord. You see the transcendent God, the eternal other, the holy, the creator, redeemer, and yet that transcendent God is not only, O Lord, but he's our Lord. We bring the transcendent into the immanent. We bring the eternal into the finite. We bring the God of the universe into our own lives. What a magnificent, magnificent dichotomy or dialectic. O Lord, our Lord. Now, how majestic is thy name in all the earth. And I want to say this in closing about this. Friends, we have a tendency to dichotomize life and man into the secular and the sacred aspects. But I want you to know God is God of all the earth and of all time. There is no such thing as the secular and the sacred to God. There are no special days to God. There are no special activities. All of life belongs to God. And man in his entirety belongs to God. There are everything we do, God has a part of. God cares about every aspect of our lives. God is concerned about every moment, every day. God has a plan and a will. We are to live Christ-like lives in every area of our lives, every moment of our lives. There is no dichotomy of life. Christianity is primarily not setting aside certain days of the week. It is not doing certain activities once or repetitively. Christianity is primarily not even a creed to be signed, but Christianity is a life to be lived in the presence of God that permeates every area and every action, every priority of our life. You see, God has made us so unique that we have great honor and great dignity and great worth. Now, I just really get upset theologically, what I call worm theology, that we're just lower than the slum on a catfish's belly. We're just worms. Now, friends, we are sinful, and we do have a fallen nature, and we do rebel against God, and we're going to have to answer for it. But we are made in His image. We carry the stamp of the only Creator, Redeemer, God. You are somebody because of the value that God has placed on you, even if you don't place value on yourself, and even if your actions don't merit value, you have great value to God. Remember that. You have worth and dignity. Now, just a little postscript, because I think Hebrews 2 should be brought into your lesson. In Hebrews 2, you ought to read that. It speaks of the humanity of Jesus and the deity of Jesus. It uses this thing about man having dominion to speak about Jesus having ultimate dominion. It uses the fact that Jesus is the ideal man to speak about our worth, and then it just transcends that to Jesus as the ultimate man, the ideal man, who has dominion not just over the physical things of earth, but over everything. He is the cosmic Lord of all that is. And so Hebrews 2 uses this psalm and Genesis to play on the dichotomy that Jesus is fully man, and yet He's fully God. He shares our majesty, but He shares majesty far beyond ours. He shares our dominion given by God originally. See, God wanted to give us so much, but when we fell, He couldn't do it. Jesus has ultimately fulfilled all of God's dominion, all of God's stewardship, all of God's responsibility for man. Jesus has fulfilled that and has given it back to God as a gift. That's why He can die on our behalf, for our sins and not for His own. I've really enjoyed being with you. I hope you'll read Genesis 1 and 2 in context completely. Then I hope you'll read Psalms 8, and then I hope you'll read Hebrews 2. There's tremendous things here. One of the worst things in our society is that most of the people in our society have poor self-images. They don't feel like they're worth anything, or their lives mean anything, or they have ultimate significance. This lesson, you can impart to them the honor and wonder of being a creation of God, and if they trust Jesus Christ by faith, of being an eternal child of God. I've enjoyed being with you, and I'll see you again, same time, same place, next week.